the department faculty, as well as especially Dr. Bhagiraj, who has approached me some time back. And initially I was a little hesitant to talk because my teaching experience is only 11 years. And I thought there could be somebody more experienced than me. But he actually insisted me to participate in this event as a resource person. So I'm very much thankful to Dr. Bhagiraj. Thank you, Dr. Bhagiraj. Incidentally, my father is a teacher. He is a school teacher, now retired. And I never thought that I would become a teacher because I was not having any idea of entering into the teaching field. I dreamed to become a researcher only in the industrial research. Even though I got some opportunity, but due to some personal reasons, I opted the teaching profession later in 2008. So 2008 onwards, I have been teaching both for undergraduate students as well as postgraduate students. And with this background, I thought, let me share my experiences, not as a resource person, but as a fellow co-worker of all of you, because I know that all of you are from different disciplines and different institutions of different caliber, and most of you are above my level also. There are senior people are here, and I don't want to make it as an expert lecture. Rather than I wanted to make it as a sharing of my experiences in the past 12 years and my understanding about the higher education, as well as the importance of teaching and learning process in this thing. Let me share this slides now. Is the slide visible to all of you? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir,
it's visible. Right. So I request all of you to mute your audio and so that it will be not disturbing to the entire lecture. Like I'd like to, in another 45 to 50 minutes, I'll be discussing about the various innovative teaching and learning methods as of my understanding and my experience. So I would like to start the lecture with the quote from the former chief of South Africa, Nelson Mandela. He once quoted that education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. So he called the education as a weapon. Considering his views, I take it as personally, the education is a double-edged knife. One edge is the student and the other edge is the teacher. Both are equal, sharing equal responsibility. Both are having equal responsibility and equal role to play in the execution of education. The education is always a two-way interaction. Most of the, it is not a down-to-up or up-to-down approach, but still it is a two-way interaction, horizontal interaction, where the teaching and learning, I would like to present here as learning and as well as the teaching, because teaching should go second seat and learning should come the first, because the ultimate aim of the education is not to teach, it is make the people to learn. So that is what I feel, and the learning and teaching are the two-way interaction to succeed the education. Giving or receiving end, both have equal role. Both if the teacher or student, both have equal role. I would like to say that teacher and learner relationship should be of much reliable one, and it should be of much appreciable one. Then only the purpose of education would be served. So why we have to think about the innovative teaching and learning methods? Are we not innovative because the humankind have been into the education for almost 2000 years or 1500 years. All these years we have a different school of education methods, and whether those methods are not innovative or so. It is not so. Every time the education is education which includes the teaching and learning is an innovative practice only. But still now, at present stage, where in the internet era as well as in the era of ICT, we are having so many challenges and which is pushing towards finding more innovative teaching and learning methods. That's what I would like to say, that necessity is the mother of invention. So we have a necessity to become innovative. So what are all those necessity? Let us look into the background of IUC survey, All India Survey of Higher Education, which the UGC conducts every year, MHRD conducts every year. The report, latest report in 2009, says that in the Indian context alone, we have somewhere around 993 universities with more than 40,000 colleges and 10,000 plus standalone institutions. So we have close to 50,000 higher education institutions, where about 40% of the higher education is in the private hands. More than 40% of the universities are located in the rural area. So we have the gross enrollment ratio in higher education roughly around 25%, whereas in the advanced countries it is more than that. But still, we are having the new national education policy rolled out by this present government is aiming to achieve almost 40-50% of gross enrollment ratio in the higher education. So all these things makes us the gross enrollment ratio, as well as increasing number of institutions and increasing number of institutions in the private sector, and more institutions from the rural background, are forcing us to find new and innovative teaching methods, teaching and learning methods. So we are living in the fast evolving global trend. So we have some time back seen the OS, different OS system, and every year the operating systems are changing, the mobile operating systems are changing. So the technical world is fast evolving, and we have to cope up with the technical world, both in education as well as the other aspects. The education is now privatized, and there are ocean of opportunities for education. So we have in the previous maybe in another maybe before 10 or 20 years, there is no the competition for higher education was more and more. For example, when I have written entrance examination for MSc admission at University of Madras in the year 2000, there were 400 people competed for the 20 seats. Around 400 people have competed for the 20 seats. But now there are only 70 people. Last year I learned from the university that there are only 70 people have written the entrance examination for the same 20 seats. Now the opportunities are more. Private institutions have come up, and they are because the education is privatized, and money income is also coupled with the education, it creates a lot of competition among the institution. So we have to face the innovations in teaching and learning methods. And more importantly, the education is now becoming more technology enabled by the introduction of information communication technology. I will come to this later in detail. Because of this introduction of ICT methods and technology enabled education, we are forced to have more innovative teaching and learning methods. And after all, the students are much informed with high exposure. The student who is studying second standard or third standard, he can browse in the YouTube, and he can learn things by his own. From the level of, from the age of 7 itself, students are now highly informed. When they are coming out from the school, they are almost having all the forum as well as all the methods to learn. So they are not coming to the university only for learning. There is some other aspects we have to provide to them. So up above their resources, like internet, televisions, and peers, they have great sources of information. And the teachers are now in the forceful environment to provide more and more than that is present outside the world. So we have to have more innovative teaching and learning methods to cope up with the highly informed and the highly exposed students of modern times. If you look at the teaching and learning methods, there are two types of learning methods people are long been discussing. One is teacher-centered approach, and another is student-centered approach. In the case of teacher-centered approach, main role is played by the teachers. Teachers are playing the main role. And the mode of delivery is through lecture and direct instruction in the way of practical classes or in the way of simulations. And the measuring of the success in the teacher-centered is done through tests and assignments and examinations. And the type of assessment will be end-semester examination. Whereas if you compare the student-centered learning methods, instead of teachers playing the major role, both teachers and students are playing equal role. The teachers here play a role of facilitator than the role of knowledge giver. So the teacher should not be the modern day teacher. They should not think that they are giving the knowledge to the students. They have to think that they are sharing the knowledge and they are facilitating the students to enhance their knowledge level. So that is what it is envisaged in the student-centered approach to learning. Whereas if you come to the mode of student-centered learning, the teachers facilitate student learning. They are not teaching, they are facilitating. And the measuring of success comes through formal and informal methods of assessment. And I will come to that later. There is a method called outcome-based education, where both formal and informal assessments are considered as measuring of the success of the program. And the type of assessment, here it is continuously assessed. That's what every institute, every higher education institute in India have now come to this stage, student-centered, and there is a blend of both these methods being followed in all the education institutes, where the continuous internal assessments are part of the curriculum. So this is what I was mentioning, outcome-based education. It is a student-centered teaching and learning methodology in which the course delivery assessment are planned to achieve stated objectives and outcomes. In the previous, for example, before 10 years or so, where the outcome-based education has not taken much importance among the Indian system, because later the introduction of MBA accreditation, that too in professional degree courses only, this outcome-based education is widely followed. I'd like to mention that this outcome-based education is widely followed in professional educational institutions like engineering and other medical institutions. So it is a student-centric method wherein the syllabus will be having the objectives and outcomes. Previously, when I was studying and all, I was not having any objective for the course or outcome for the course, but the subjects will be there. Like each subject will be having 5 or 4 units, and sometimes the contents will be very much limited, and that is the stage now, that time. But still, in the case of outcome-based education, each and every syllabus of the each and every course having syllabus with the details of what is the syllabus aiming to get out from the students. That means what are the objectives of the particular course to be imparted as an outcome for the students. So this outcome-based education focuses on measuring the student performance, that is outcome, at different levels, both at the semester level, at the end semester level. And I think from the people from the engineering background understand this concept very well. They assess the outcomes even after 4 years of the student completing the course. There is a program outcomes are there that is being assessed after 2 years of the student passing out from the institution. So it is largely looking at the outcomes at different levels. So it firstly identifies what are all the objectives of the courses and fixes the expected outcomes from the student. For example, if a particular student, you take, for example, engineering mathematics, one subject, what is the objective of the subject? What are all the things it relates to the students? And it will also have outcomes. That means after studying the course, how this will be bringing the outcome from the students, what students will be able to do. So those things are all called as outcomes. So the outcome-based education formulates the content around the activities that leads to specific outcome. It is also called as activity-based education. Mostly, the outcome-based education's curriculum and syllabus warrants more kind of activities. For example, it has internships, it has industry visits as well as mini projects and all as the components. So in 1991 and in 1994, the outcome-based education was proposed by William Spady. So this is now taking in recent years, this outcome-based education is gaining momentum in most of the professional institutions across India. So what are all the important aspects of the outcome-based education? I would like to mention only the keywords, and I request the participants to have more information about this thing from the internet. So course means the subject they are calling it as course, and engineering mathematics, for example, it is a course. Course outcome is a statement that describes the significant and essential learning that learners have achieved. And program is like your BE program, BE marine engineering is a program. So each and every program will have program outcomes. Program outcome means after studying BE marine engineering, what is the student can able to do, what he is expected to be able to do by the time of graduation. That is what called as program outcomes. And each and every program will have program educational objectives. That means what are all the objective statements that describe the expected outcome achievements of the graduates in their career. That is called as program educational outcomes. The program educational outcomes are defined, previously defined. There is a accord called Washington Accord, which has defined what are all the statements to be given for the program educational objectives. And each and every different program will be having program specific outcomes. The program specific outcomes may be 3 or 4 per program, and that will tell what the students should be able to do at the time of graduation with reference to a specific discipline. For example, the program educational PEOs are common to all engineering programs, whereas PSO, the program specific outcomes, are specific to the particular program, for example, BE marine engineering. So the graduate attributes are the exemplars of the attributes expected of a graduate from an accredited program. It is the overall expectation of what a BE graduate can able to do. So these are the stated program outcomes which are already been defined, and most of the institutions are following this 12 program outcomes in their programs. So I don't want to read out everything. And this is the program outcome for general higher education programs, which is of 3-year nature. And the previous one, this is for engineering and technology programs, 4-year program. And this is for the other undergraduate programs of general in nature. But this particular concept is now picking up only now in the case of arts and science programs. And those who are working with the NAC accreditation, for example, if they are in the IQAC team, they must be understanding that the revised university manual of the NAC has 30 marks weightage for the outcome-based education principles. So if at all you follow the outcome-based education only, you will be able to score that 30 marks. So now, slowly this concept is picking up both in the arts and science colleges also. Earlier, it was limited only to the professional courses of engineering and technology disciplines and management. But now slowly, because of the need of NAC accreditation, and because of the NAC has given much emphasis on the outcome-based education, now the arts and science colleges are also following this education. And I am from a science background. The department what I am working is a science department. It is my MSc Marine Biotechnology we are offering. And we are also following this outcome-based education. So the outcome-based education, the most important aspect is it defines the knowledge levels of assessment of outcomes based on a methodology called Bloom's taxonomy. So Bloom's is a Bloom's taxonomy differentiate the knowledge into 6 levels. Level one is remembering. When was the Jallianwala Bagh massacre has happened? It is a kind of remembering of knowledge. And understanding, it is like what is called global warming. It is like you are reproducing what you understand. So applying, so you have some concept. For example, in the case of mathematics and other algebra calculations, you'll be applying the concepts to find solutions and analyzing. For example, in the business school and other areas, they'll be giving some case studies and questions will be asked that will be analyzing. And most of the project-based studies are coming under evaluating. And creating is like you are creating prototypes or machines or new concepts. Those and all are high level of education. But mostly the undergraduate programs will end up with knowledge level 4, analyzing level only. But the higher PG programs as well as research programs, PhD, they go up to the level of 6. And rarely, sometimes some of the courses may have level 6 based off knowledge also may be there. So these are the committees which are helpful for administrating the outcome-based education. Program coordinator will be there. Each and every program, instead of we are calling it as the general science program and Arts and Science College, we call it as HOD. There also will be a HOD, but there will be a program coordinator, because a single department may conduct two or three programs. For example, one same department may conduct BSc Botany, MSc Botany, MPhil Botany, and PhD Botany. So there will be one single HOD, and in the case of outcome-based education, you have to have a coordinator for BSc Botany, you have to have a coordinator for MSc Botany and MPhil Botany and this thing, and there will be a coordinator. With reference to course coordinator, each and every course should have a coordinator. For example, the one subject, for example, if you take environmental science, it has been taken all over the institution by a single department, by a few faculty. For example, 1,000 students are attending the course, and there will be 5 or 6 different faculty handling the same course. So there will be a course coordinator, single coordinator, who will coordinate all the 5 people, other people. That is called as course coordinator. And in the case of module coordinator or specialization coordinator, each and every degree program will be divided into some kind of specialization. For example, botany, if you take, the people have classified botany into algology, mycology, and plant pathology, something like that. So each and every module will have a special coordinator. And there will be a program performance assessment committee, which relates the assessment of the program performance every semester. And the department advisory committee will be having external experts also, that will give the overall guidance to the program. So I'm not going into the detail of the outcome-based education. I just wanted to throw some light on the newly emerging concept of education. So this outcome-based education is extremely student-centered. It has a clarity in focus, what the student is aiming to study, what he will become after the course completion. Those details will be given in clarity in the curriculum itself. And they follow the design down and deliver up. That means before designing the curriculum, they do much care, and while delivering, they practice the most advanced methodologies to bring the more outcome from the students. And the expectations are always exceeding. It is the excellent model. I personally, this model is, and it has expanded. It is not limited. The opportunities are highly expanded, and it will help all the accreditation bodies to give more emphasis. So, if you have a outcome-based model, definitely you can face all the accreditation processes like MBA or NAC or ABET or whatever it is. Yeah. So now coming to the innovative teaching and learning methods, what for these innovative and teaching methods are to be discussed? Because the student learning process, we have to enhance. The learning process of the students, we have to enhance. We have to improve the student engagement. This is what I told in the very first slide itself. Students are highly informed. They are more, sometimes more knowledgeable than the teacher itself. And they have all information. For example, if you are teaching a concept in the class, they can just like that do the Google search and find more information, and they can bring some advanced information also. So those time, we have to put our extra efforts. The teachers have to put extra efforts to engage the students. And we have to enhance the motivation as well as the attainment level of students. And for a productive...
Sir, we are not able to see the PPT, sir.
Okay. Just a second, madam. I'm presenting it again. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the goals of innovative teaching and learning methods are, we have to enhance the student learning process, we have to improve the student engagement, we have to bring the students into the classroom atmosphere, and we have to enhance the motivation and attainment level of the students. And for a productive teacher-learner relationship, we have to follow innovative teaching and learning methods. B means, I am not mentioning the teachers alone. Here the B means both the teachers, students, and the management, the institution as a whole. All have equal role to have innovative teaching and learning methods for the productive teacher and learner relationship for the ultimate enhancement of students' learning process. the challenges in the modern day teaching, what are all the challenges? I have given this particular link at the right side down of the my presentation. There you can have more information, but I wanted to emphasize few things here. So what are all the challenges in modern day teaching? The more
Hello, first, sir.
Yes madam.
Sir, this is Jayashree Patil. Sound is somewhat echo, sir.
Whether other people also having same problem?
No, sir. We are
audible. Not get
no,
the
we
sound.
Are listening properly. Yeah.
No, no, sir. Actually, a presentation and like your voice both are very clear. Due to some network problem, other participants may like face.
Yeah, that's what
I need to check in your internet.
Correct.
Okay, I think I can progress.
And please mute your
yes,
audio.
Please continue. So
please carry on, sir.
So all the participants, please mute your audio as well as video, so that you can have enhanced bandwidth. Like, so there are multiple challenges for the modern day teachers. Firstly, teachers are have to spend much of their energy in the effective classroom management, because we have to be more interesting. Like the artist, like the cinema artist, they are performing in the cinema. We have to perform well during the class hours. Otherwise, students will lost their attention, and we have to be classroom managers. We have to manage the classroom very well, because the classroom, we have to make it into a creative and collaborative and effective learning environment. That what should be a main motto of a teacher. So we have to follow creative methods, and we have to make the students to get collaborated in the teaching practices, and also it ultimately helps us to effective learning management system. And I want to bring a small information here, my personal experience. There was a teacher called Mr. Selvam. He was teaching me biochemistry at my undergraduate. So every day he used to ask one important question before starting the class. Sometime we used to answer, sometime we cannot able to answer. And in one instant, I found that the question what the teacher is getting are all obtained from a TV program called Turning Point. The Turning Point was the program which was telecasted in Doordarshan those days. Every day they will be discussing some amount of scientific information, and they will be giving some extra knowledge. So it will be telecasted around 11 o'clock or 11:30, and I studied in an evening college at 2 o'clock. The teacher has the habit of watching the program every day, and he will ask the same question in the class. So later sometime I found that this particular secret, and I also started watching the Turning Point every day, and I used to answer the teacher every day in a proper manner. So this is how there are some ways every teacher will have their own methodology to make the classroom into an effective learning environment. So this helped me to learn a lot of things. That's what I wanted to bring, my personal experience. And the teachers have to learn soft skills, have to learn soft skills or develop the soft skills, because the teachers at the school level, they have studied B.Ed or M.Ed programs, and even the primary school teachers are having formal education. Education is a different sector, but in the higher education, for example, in the degree programs, we are not having specific training to teach. Definitely our education system has this flaw. For example, I have completed even PhD, but I have not taken a single course how to teach. I have not have proper training, specific training for teaching, but still I learned teaching only when I come into the field. So that is why every teacher has to have some training or personal training. Now there are more modes are there. We have to have soft skills like personal habits, how to manage people, how to bring the leadership among the students, and how to take the control over the class by different approach. Here also I have one personal experience. One Mr. Selvin, he was my English teacher at my undergraduation. One day he asked a particular question. I wanted the meaning of somalification. those who understand Tamil, they can understand the trick in this thing. He asked what is the meaning of Samalipikation, and he was raising each and every student, do you know, do you know? So I was in the somewhere in the last third bench I was. So I gave the answer actually. I said that the Samalipikation is like Samalipu. That means, what to say? It is the combination of both Samalipu and Samalipikation, both are combination of English and Tamil word. The same case you might have experienced in the movie. Three idiots are Nanban in Tamil. There, the main actor used to have the same practice. So this is how a teacher can bring the control over the class, and they can increase their personal habits, or they know how to manage the people, and they know how to bring the best from the students. And the third most challenge what today teachers are having is stress and conflict management. And most of you, most of us are from the private organization. We definitely must have work related stress, and there must be several deadlines. And I must admit that now the teachers are not only having teaching job, they also have many more admin related works because of the pressure from the organization. And also the accreditation programs requires more amount of file works than that of the core teaching works. So this work related stress actually affects the personal behavior, physical status, as well as psychological well-being of the teachers, which in turn affect the teaching learning process. This will also be crucial in handling parents. And more importantly, we have to have more efficient stress and conflict management while we are handling the indisciplined students. So most of the students, we cannot expect same discipline like others. There must be at least 10% of students who are not so disciplined, and that will affect the classroom atmosphere. And we have to have a proper training as well as proper understanding about the stress and conflict management during the classroom teaching. So the challenges in modern day teaching, and it continues, the teachers have to have a very good communication skill, both in the form of vocabulary, grammar usage, and effective English usage. Because the presentation of lecture is mainly to inform the student, influence the student, as well as it has to entertain the student. So we have to have a very good communication skill with good vocabulary and grammar and effective English. Structuring and effective planning of the classroom session is more important. We have to, I think I have visited one institution in Coimbatore. I don't want to mention the institution name. It's a private institution. They have segregated the 60 minutes of the class into three areas. First 10 minutes, they used to wrap up the previous day lecture. And another 30 to 40 minutes, they discuss the today's lecture. And last 10 minutes, they give it as a discussion forum. So they handle the class only for 40 minutes. 10 minutes, they do the recap. And another 10 minutes, they introduce the next day information as well as today's information they are discussing. So likewise, we ourselves have to structure the lecture session, as well as we have to plan very effectively. The another challenge what we have in the modern day teaching is handling of diverse students. Not all students are equal category. Some are slow and some are advanced learners. And we have to actually do the coaching, but not exactly the teaching, because the emotional intelligence of the students will be different. Not all students will be in the same emotional level. We have to handle all those things very carefully. The students, this is what I was previously also discussed. Students are highly informed. They have good exposure from the school age onwards. They have the access to many gadgets and devices. They have multiple forums to learn. So they are highly informed. We have to provide them more and more new information, or the information in a more attractive way. So these are all the challenges for modern day teachers. So what are all the approaches to the effective teaching learning? We have seen the challenges. What we can do to make the teaching learning process into more effective? The first and foremost thing people are suggesting is you have to implement the information communication technology, that is what shortly called as ICT, in the teaching learning process. By definition, ICT is education, mode of education where teachers use information and communication technology to support, enhance, optimize and delivery of information. It is a very tricky area. It needs exposure, experience and technical skills. Not all teachers are capable of integrating this ICT in their teaching. Still, I have seen the teachers who cannot be able to handle a laptop, who cannot be able to present a PowerPoint, who cannot be able to prepare a PowerPoint. So something like that, teachers are having some difficulties. But still, now the days are days have come that all must understand the concept of information communication technology, and we have to be in a position to master it. So it is a quite time-consuming task, but still we have to have more exposure and experience with uncompromised technical skills to effectively implement the ICT in our day-to-day teaching sessions. So there are two different aspects in the case of ICT. Different methods are there, different tools are there. Methods are how you are going to use the information communication technology into the teaching is called as method. The tools are what are all the software or what are the devices which help to implement the methods. For example, if you look at the ICT methods and techniques, we have firstly is access of course materials through remote devices. What are course materials? Like the notes or guides or video forms. Those are all called as course materials. So in the case of another 20 years back or so, mostly juniors will be depending on seniors for getting their class notes. So they are photocopied, Xeroxed and photocopied, and that is the only form of access to course material. But now we have plenty of resources, plenty of modern tools to share the course material and to prepare the course material. So these online digital repositories for lectures, course materials and digital library are part of ICT methods. And the another ICT method is online or cloud-based academic management system. It includes the attendance of students, conducting tests online, giving marks online, and assessment online, everything making online. It is all now, thanks to the cloud-based storage technology, we don't have even to have much sophisticated server systems to operate this, all these things. So they shortly call this concept as learning management system. Almost now the school levels also, they have implemented the learning management system. In one shot, they are sending SMS to all the students, all the parents that today is this is the classwork, and bring it tomorrow morning. Likewise, they send messages. So all these things are possible only through the LMS, which is cloud supported. And flipped classroom is one of the most important interesting way of ICT implementation into the classroom lecture. That I will come to that later, flipped classroom later. So making use of ICT devices such as handheld computers, tablets, laptops, audio players, projector devices, and smart boards, interactive whiteboards, all those things are come under use of ICT devices. So to achieve these all five functions, what are all the devices we have? We have simulation devices, simulators are there. The simulator may be a software or it may be a device, it may be an instrument. So it is an ICT tool. And there are some modeling softwares are there. For example, in the people from the engineering background, they know that modeling softwares are there, CAD/CAM softwares are there. And you have devices like CD-ROMs or now pen drives have come, flash drives have come. And we have web publishing as a tool. And we can use spreadsheets, Excel sheets for the teaching learning purposes. We have many databases like LMS, Google Classroom, etc. we have. And through email also we can operate ICT methods. And even through WhatsApp as well as Facebook, people have started offering the ICT methods in the education. And you can use their smart boards, interactive whiteboards, etc. for the implementation of ICT. And altogether, internet browsing is required for all this implementation of ICT methods by the usage of these different ICT tools. So the another approach for the effective teaching learning process is new technology and implementation of social media into the education system. There are very many web platforms like YouTube, Google Classroom, and even WhatsApp, or now Facebook. You can, I think some time back I attended a whole live session from the AICD chairman through Twitter live. I attended the whole webinar. So this thing, I found that one of my friend, Dr. Felix, he is working in the Central University of Punjab biology department. He is the professor there. His online course has been rated as 7th best online course in the world. I think for my experience, he is handling the new technologies as well as social media. Is there any problem? Hello?
No, sir, you can continue, sir.
Anyway, so this person, this Dr. Felix, he is using almost all kind of platforms, YouTube, Google Classroom, even WhatsApp or Facebook or Twitter. And I have given the link to him, how he is engaging all these platforms into the education. You can look into for a better experience. So he is conducting tests even in Facebook also. He is making polls in Facebook, and they integrate everything into the social networks. There are social networks like Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, ResearchGate. All these things can be used for teaching learning process. And this is the example of the pages from Google Classroom. It is a free of service. Most of the institutions are having paid versions of LMS. And those institutions who cannot afford LMS or other ERP systems, they can take up this Google Classroom, which is free of cost. And this is having very many supporting systems to use the ICT into the education. For example, in the first left upper side of the left, you can see that the study materials like PowerPoint presentations and as well as notes, handouts, guides, everything can be uploaded in the Google Classroom. And secondly, announcements you can make. When is the test? Likewise, because this particular Google Classroom was very much effective during the lockdown period. I have operated entire my lecture sessions through this Google Classroom only. So we have used the Google Meet app for the classroom delivery, lecture delivery, and we have uploaded all the study materials into the Google Classroom, and we have announced when will be the class. For example, tomorrow we have class at 2:30 p.m. on the so-and-so topic. Everyone should come to this following link. So if we announce it, that's all over, students will come and they will attend the lecture. And for example, you can have test over here in the Google Classroom itself. You can conduct test. The test can be both objective type or descriptive type. And in the same Google Classroom platform itself, you can have grades. I have given the, you can see that I have given the marks for each and every student for test one, test two. Likewise, it can go on. So whatever you are doing in the classroom, you can do everything in this virtual classroom. That is what Google Classroom is for. So now coming to the another important aspect, that is flipped classroom. Flipped means reversed. Actually, the technical, the literal meaning of flipped is reversed. So in the case of, if you look at the picture in the down right side, the traditional classroom, lecture is given by a single teacher. And in the classroom, almost 60 or 40 students will be attending the lecture. And in the home, they do activities like problem solving or assignments or something like that. The students will be doing alone. This is what happens in the traditional classroom type. And in the case of flipped classroom, the lecture will be delivered previously to all the students. For example, the previously recorded video lectures will be sent to all the students. They will be asked to view the lecture at their home. And in the classroom, they will be given activity. For example, you can if you are teaching the activity of the functional activity of a turbine, and you can have the lecture delivered to the students through WhatsApp or whatsoever the manner, and students will be watching the lecture at home, and they can come prepared. They can come prepared for questions or come prepared for more information. And wherein in the classroom, the teacher will be facilitating the classroom activities, the group activities like quiz. You can conduct a group discussion, and you can even conduct the debates. So what kind of information also you can deliver in the classroom activities. So in the case of traditional classroom, lecture is delivered at the class, but in the case of flipped class, activities are being conducted in the classroom instead of lecture. But we in our institution, we have followed this method. We have made it as a trial basis. All the teachers have to conduct minimum one flipped class per week, because we cannot have all the classes into flipped classes. The flipped classes are limited to certain type of lectures only. Not all the subjects are, not all the areas can be fit into the flipped class, but still it is an wonderful opportunity for the students to gain first class exposure prior to class. For example, the textbooks, reading materials, videos, podcasts, screencast, etc. can be shared to the students well in advance through various media like WhatsApp or YouTube or Facebook. And this provides a mechanism to assess the students' understanding pre-classes. And it provides in-class activities that focus on high-level cognitive activities. So teaching is one way of engaging the students at the class, but there are very many different activities like problem-solving methods, discussion, debates, quiz programs, or even projects, or assignment writing, web assignment making. So all these aspects can be conducted in the classroom instead of a lecture session for the whole 1 hour. So this is called as flipped classroom. Flipped classroom means that the students gain first exposure to the new material outside of the class, usually through reading or lecture videos, and then use class time to do harder work of assimilating that particular knowledge, and perhaps through the problem solving, discussion or debates. So traditional methods activities are held at home. Flipped classroom activities are conducted in the classroom. So in the next approach to the effective teaching learning process is the effective usage of e-learning platforms. Now e-learning is gaining momentum, particularly in this lockdown period. E-learning has made tremendous implications in the form of education. Because, for example, in our university, we have compulsorily made that a particular student has to study minimum of 3 online courses in e-learning platforms before they complete the course. For example, in our department, MSc Marine Biotechnology, we have 2 papers in the final semester, that is in the 4th semester MSc. We have 2 papers. We had 2 papers actually, and now we have made the 2 papers as e-learning courses, because the courses, the platforms such as Swayam or NPTEL or Coursera, edX, Udemy, these platforms, students can take up the online courses and they can study online. They can write the exams conducted by the MOOC platforms and bring the certificate, and that marks we can incorporate into the final semester. So that is what we have made. This is called massive open online courses. At a time, 1 lakh student, 2 lakh students can take the single course. For example, this time our students have taken 2 courses and they have written examination and they have got a degree, the certificates before the lockdown period itself. Now we have closed for lockdown. The final students, absolutely they were not having any problem because they have already completed required number of 2 courses through online. So these online courses can be accessed from anywhere, anytime. That is the most important benefit of this particular program. It saves a great amount of time and money. It improves the productivity as well as provide better academic results. The e-learning enables students to learn subject at a time and the pace of their convenience. So the time and the speed, the student can complete in the course in 2 weeks or 3 weeks, or he can study the subject in the midnight, and he can watch the lecture in the early morning. So whatever the time he feels comfortable, he can go through the course, and he can, anytime he can take the test. So that is the more important aspect of e-learning platforms. It is quite cost effective. For example, the NPTEL offers the certificate programs for about 1,000 rupees only. The Udemy, the private platform, offers the courses for minimum 400 rupees. A single course costs only 400 rupees. They will give you 2 weeks course, and they will deliver around 30 hours lecture, conduct test and give certificate in 400 rupees. I have advised my students to take up this private platform one and government platform NPTEL one, and my students have taken that one only. It is cost effective. So e-learning is much more sophisticated, time sophisticated, dynamic and quick learning process. the continued e-learning platforms, it enables everyone to increase their skills. For example, I wanted to learn more about this outcome-based education because I am not from an engineering and technology background. I am from a science background and presently working in an institution where I have to handle the science and technology programs as well as engineering programs also as an administrator. So I wanted to learn more about this outcome-based education, and luckily last year I have attended this particular e-learning course called Outcome-Based Education offered by one of the IIT professor in the NPTEL platform, and I got certified. And now I have little knowledge because I have developed myself into the area of outcome-based education. So the most important, another most important aspect of e-learning platform is it is paperless. No paper is involved, no transportation required. So it reduces the total energy consumption, and in the environmental point of view, 90% of the energy consumption is being reduced because the transportation you no need to have, while lowering the carbon dioxide emission by almost 85%. So the e-learning method ensures that a continuous and consistent evolution, evaluation can be undertaken to assess. And we have digital contents or e-contents to support the e-learning experience or ICT methods. The digital content or e-content are part of e-learning process. So e-content means there is some disturbance. Somebody have unmuted their audio. Please mute your audio. Thank you. So what are all the types of e-contents? What are all the materials called as e-contents? PowerPoint presentation is a e-content. Guide, for example, if you are taking a subject and you make a 20-page write-up, that is a guide and report. So chart as well as graphs and webinars, podcast, audio recordings are called as podcast. Games, you can develop games through the games, you can educate students. Cartoon and illustration are part of e-contents. Videos, case studies, infographics, simulations, screen captures, animated GIFs, e-books, articles, blog posts, everything comes under the part of digital contents or e-contents. This digital contents or e-contents are one of the integral components of the MOOC. They comprise of, they may be a text format, audio format or video format or animated format. The government is also supporting large, in larger manner to enhance the digital e-contents. For example, the MHRD through UGC has instituted a consortium for educational communication, CEC, which gives financial assistance for the teachers to develop these e-contents. To start with, I recommend the teachers, so those who are not into the development of e-contents, you can look into a website called Vidya Mitra. It is an initiative of the MHRD where it is hosting thousands and thousands of e-contents, and they are not asking any money from us, and they are also not giving any financial assistance. But still, for example, you have developed only one video and you wanted to make the every people to access it, you can contact this Vidya Mitra and they can make it. PowerPoint presentation, if you are having an original PowerPoint presentation, you can deliver it there. And remember, all these e-contents, digital contents are having weightage when you are applying for career advancement scheme for the from the promotion of assistant professor to associate professor, from the associate professor to professor, and even if you are applying to a government institution, e-content development is one of the main criteria for the selection of both assistant professor, associate and professor. So it now the government has given much emphasis on the digital content preparation. So now I come to the end session. I have listed out a few of the thoughts for innovations in teaching and learning. Firstly, teachers must have passion for the subject. You have to love your subject, otherwise you cannot have the command over the subject and you cannot have the command over the class. If you don't have a subject knowledge and if you don't have the interest in the subject, you cannot handle the class. Structure the lesson delivery into different parts like introduction, theme, summary, and what are the questions to be asked. That means you have to prepare well before you go into the class. For example, every time when I have a class, I will have at least 20 minutes of rehearsal or briefing. That is what I still follow. For this presentation also, I have spent almost 2 days, 2 whole days to prepare the PowerPoint slide. And this morning, I have taken 2 or 3 times rehearsal. So I expect a teacher should be this much dedicated to structure the lesson delivery, because the classroom lecture is a kind of art actually. So that art we have to take care. So modulate the mindset, mood, and overall classroom ambience. So once you go into the class, your dressing sense, your body language, everything matters. You have to create a mindset among the students. You have to inculcate the mood among the students, and you have to control. You have to take control over the overall classroom ambience. If the student don't like the teacher, definitely he will not like the subject. For example, if you ask anybody what is the most unlikely subject for you, somebody will say mathematics. And if you ask them why you are not liking mathematics, because I don't like my mathematics teacher. For example, I am telling, not I am branding mathematics, but still. It is all depends on this one, how the teacher attracts the students. And if a teacher attracts the student, definitely he make the students to attract the subject also. So you have to use open-ended questions. That means real world events and contemporary issues you have to bring in. You always not to be very much stick on to the syllabus as well as the course contents only. You have to have some open-ended questions which are relevant to the subjects you are handling. You have to encourage the leadership skills. Engage slow learners in some of the activities. For example, I used to always give some of the classroom coordination works always to the slow.
Yeah, participants, please wait for a few minutes. The guests will come back to you. Thank you.
Hello.
Madam, you just wait. Okay. The guests will join, madam. Some of the technical errors.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Hello.
Hi, yes, sir.
Dear participants, please stay online. The resource person will join us back now. Okay. Please stay back.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Yeah, yes.
Excuse me, ma'am. Excuse me.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello.
Hello, sir. Am I speaking to the organizers?
Yes, yes. Tell me, ma'am.
Ma'am, yesterday we couldn't get in, and the live streaming was also not working properly. We did not get the feedback.
Maybe some technical issue. We'll send the feedback form and the link to your mail IDs. To your registered mail IDs, you will receive the feedback link.
Okay, because yesterday's feedback we did not get, and live streaming was also not working. So that was a big issue yesterday, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Thank you for the response.
Thank you, ma'am. Please send the feedback.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
The same thing happened to me, ma'am, also.
Do you screen see my screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'm extremely sorry for the difficulty. I don't know what happened.
Okay.
So let me continue. So we were talking about we have to encourage the leadership skill among the students by engaging both slow learners as well as advanced learners. We have to create a flexible learning environment. For example, we can improvise the peer learning among themselves. So we can form some small groups of students and ask them to do some kind of group seminars or group quiz programs or collaborative activities we can improvise. And we can also introduce some of the problem finding exercise as well as problem solving exercises. And more importantly, we can introduce the flipped classroom model. And there are some teachers who still follow non-formal education, that somebody like I was mentioning about Dr. Felix from Punjab University. He takes his classes mostly in outdoor. That means he takes out all his students out of the classroom, and they sit in a sit under a tree and handle the classes. This is not possible for all the educational institutes, but still it is one way of innovating the teaching and learning. Wherever possible resources are there, we can have a trial over this one. So the another thing is you can invite entrepreneurs as well as alumni into our classrooms in various ways. We can ask them to give expert lecture or guest lecture. In the university where I am working, we have made it as a practice that any one unit of the entire year's program, any one unit of the entire program should be handled by industry expert or alumni. Actually, this is increasing the contact of students with the industry experts as well as alumni. In one way, it is giving a different kind of experience, because industry experts as well as alumni, their approach will be different, because they are not actually teachers, and the teacher's view is different, and the experts working in the professional, their view is different. So it will give a different experience, and it also enhances the opportunity of having placements. So you have to welcome new ideas. If a student comes with new idea, we have to accept. So firstly, we have to shed away the idea of teachers are the boss in the class. We are not actually the boss in the class. We are the facilitator in the class. We are there to guide the students, not to dictate the students. We have to keep in mind. So we have to encourage the club activities as well as society chapters. And we can conduct more kind of contest within the students. This is one way of making students to learn more eagerly. And we have to encourage the students to participate in different innovation contests as well as conferences. For example, in our department, I used to ask all the PG students to have minimum attend 3 or 4 conferences in a semester. In a semester, we will be giving them some mini projects. We will, for example, one subject, marine pharmacology, if it is having 10 experiments, we will design a mini project in such a way that all the 10 experiments will be part of the project. So students will will be learning the 10 experiments, and at a time they will also have research material for presenting in conferences. So likewise, you can improvise the experience of learning in different way. We can encourage the students to give more amount of seminars, and we can encourage field trips, projects, and other group assignments to enhance the student experience in the teaching learning process. And more importantly, we can use the technology like smart boards, mobile games, and virtual classroom simulators and e-labs. And there is a upcoming technology called virtual reality and augmented reality, which will extremely going to change the entire science and technology as well as engineering way of education in the days to come. We have our institution is having a MOU with SIFI Technologies in India. They have found a device for virtual reality as well as augmented reality. Now this is five years back I am talking. Now these devices are available in Amazon for purchase. They are very much commercialized now, but in the case of 5 years back, we allowed the SIFI technology to have a trial in our mechanical engineering department. There they have given these devices to our students and taken the classes, and that has been converted into a research study. And because of that study, the SIFI technologies have received the award from the President of India for the technology intervention in the engineering and technology education. So this is what the technology some 5 years back we experienced, and this technology is now getting momentum in the education process. And I think in the days to come, for example, in the post-COVID-19 scenario, we may have to utilize this virtual reality and augmented reality for more of our practical as well as lab related educational purposes. So with this brief talk, I would like to end my session by a quote from Mathia, like, teaching is a great way to keep learning. Always we wanted to learn, and thereby we have to teach. Thank you, Ananda.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, now the session is open for questions. Yeah, the participants are requested to put the questions now.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
This is Markete Jansi.
Yes, madam.
I have a question regarding Bloom's taxonomy, sir.
Yeah. Yes, madam.
In what cases we have to use for that, sir?
Madam, your voice is getting echo.
Madam, you can send the short message also. Yeah, please.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, you can just send the message, madam. Then sir can easily answer.
The discussion may not be a question or two. We can also post some further points to my lecture. You can add a few things, and you also can take some interactions.
Any more questions?
Somebody asked whether the online teaching is always good or not. So it is, online teaching is not always suggested, because it depends on the content, what content to be delivered online. By keeping the view of ICT or e-learning or online teaching methods, we cannot overlook the immense importance of physical contact, of the physical presence of teachers in the classroom, because that cannot be never ever be replaced by any technology. A teacher cannot be replaced, but the role of teacher may be little bit revised. That is what my personal opinion. But without teachers, nothing can be learned, nothing can be taught.
Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir. I have a suggestion or a kind of question from my side.
Please, madam.
Sir, as you started speaking about teaching processes and all, one of the day, I think we can flip the teacher and the student participation, where students will come and present. Instead of being just as a presentation, they can take it over an entire class and moderate as we are doing. Will that be a fine thing, sir?
Yes, madam. It is also one of the teaching methodology where it is called as inclusive teaching. Like we can include students also, peer learning, it is also coupled with peer learning. Yes. We have also some time back, myself personally have this experimentation. I have made it as an experiment. I was teaching environmental yes. science to all the UG students in my university. And there in a particular class like petroleum engineering, I have introduced this method. And I have delivered the introductory session in the time of introducing the themes only. But the actual class will be taken by a set of students who have come voluntarily. So that has actually worked very well. Students have appreciated the sessions very well, and they are more attentive than I am taking the classes, because their own friends are taking classes. They take it as very intimate. So that it actually results good. But it's not suitable for all the subjects. For theoretical kind of subjects, it is very much applicable. And very much can be useful.
Okay, thank you, sir. That's got to know now. Thank you so much, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, madam.
So please explain about the practical subjects. How can we do experiments?
I don't understand. Madam, please, madam. Please repeat, madam.
She's asking about the practical-based subjects.
Yeah, practical-based subject. That's what I have shared my personal experience. Like, instead of giving 10 experiments, I used to give a whole mini project to the students. That mini project will have these 10 experiments as components. This is very much possible for science subjects. But for engineering subjects, I think comparatively, when you compare science and engineering subjects, practical are relatively easier. You can very easily couple this experimentation with the projects. Research-based approach you can definitely give. And there are some of the practicals, especially in the case of physics or chemistry, if you give some videos previous day, and they can watch the video and perform the experiments very well in the laboratory. So the flipped classroom activity kind of thing can be also applicable in the practical thing. Now the virtual labs are also coming. For example, the government has some time back banned the dissection of animals, use of animals for dissection and other things. Instead, they have suggested the universities to look into the virtual labs.
Okay, sir.
Both for engineering and science, and many virtual labs are available now. But they are privatized labs and they need money.
Yes, sir. Exactly, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, this is Sampath.
Yeah, please, sir.
Actually, you said that there are virtual labs and they are money oriented. For example, if you go for rural areas, it means enough. For example, in some colleges, they can't be afford to take such conditions also.
Yeah.
How are we going to get that resources? Means in sponsorship or anything else from their resources at present from our AACTs or UGCs or some other things. Actually, I'm from engineering sector.
Yeah, please. Sir, I think, sir, the AICT is giving funds frequently. The AICT accredited institutions are eligible for several funds. There are many funds are there. Every year they used to ask. There is a program called RPS and AMPS. There are several programs are there in the AICT sector, especially it is very good. Recently only our institution has become accredited by AICT last 3 years back only. Last 3 years, our most of the departments are getting funds for improvising their labs and getting funds. They're getting funds. It is very much possible from the AICT point of view.
Sir, I have another question. For example, we have a simulation such a way that we are using MATLABs and all these things. I know that you can know these things, I think so. These are the, whatever the things are there, they are mostly costly and it is to be useful for the students. So if it is any such a program has been conducting by our governments or anything else, so that it is, it should be getting in benefit of a way, means as a, I can say that one has subsidies, we will say that thing. So if you, if they do such thing, it will be very useful for students also. Why? Because sometimes, if you see this time, this is the corona crisis time. While these times, we can't go for lab sessions. Only the subject knowledge can be provided to the students. So if you provide these MATLAB sessions in times of, because it can be very useful for our students also, in even in the engineering sectors. Nowadays, it is being extension to the physics and physical science, biology system, all these things. So even some of the things they have been using for making of COVID materials, all these things are tracking all these things. So I think it should be given a subsidy type of system for the government to arrest these things to the, mainly to attach to rural people,
yes, rural sir, areas. This very good discussion you created. Actually, this is having three answers, I would say. Firstly, government has to take much proactive manner what you are telling now, that they have to discuss with the service providers and they have to reduce the cost of training or cost of software, number one. Number two, the institution can also take some proactive measures. We have personally experienced in the case. We have a MOU with one of the private service provider called CAD Center in Chennai, and they have been teaching the AutoCAD. Believe that the cost what they have given to us is extremely cheaper for the case of AutoCAD software, because of the number of we have this thing, we can have a good relationship. And with the relationship, we have asked them to conduct a training session on a software called PTC to all our teachers and faculty during this COVID-19. They have conducted. So this kind of personal relationship with the industries will also helpful to the institution, number two. And number three, the government has already rolled out one agency called NSDC, National Skill Development Corporation. The National Skill Development Corporation supports financially for this kind of skill development courses. We have also example to our institution, like there is a institution in Chennai called NSIC. I don't remember the exact expansion for that one. It is giving a software training for mechanical engineers. And the software, if you learn outside, it is somewhere around 8,000 rupees per student per course module. But in the case of government subsidy, it is only 750 rupees or so. So we have been training our students in the NSIC for the past 3 years. It is very much possible, sir. Government is also giving a subsidized course, but not all the software. There are few softwares are available, and other softwares you can deal with the institutions who are providing training. It is very much possible. And even when government has...
Yes, sir, as you said that, we also... As you said, so we also got the CAD system, whatever you said, sir. And one of the CEO said NSIC. Also, they also, MOUs have been done. But the thing is that just these are the, some of these, some, for example, only I'm related not only to electronics, electrical, even MSc students and BSc students, all these are will be presented. So in spite of all these things, and we have a need of everything, so this also should be taken into consideration. That's what the reason I have been joining this meeting. And I also want to, here I think there are many faculties and many professors and doctors. Also, they know that. I think maybe. I can't say that. Don't know. Yes, I am saying, sir. Sir, if it is made.
Sir, I think you can explore the LinkedIn. You can explore the LinkedIn social platform. And you can find suitable people also who can... there are always people are there to teach free of cost for the benefit of students and other things. You can explore those things also.
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Definitely.
You can very, very thanks for your session. Yeah, okay, sir. Very thanks for your session. Very happy to present this session.
Thank you.
So any more questions?
I think if there are no questions, I profusely thank all the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity to meet electronically to all the more than 250 experienced people all over the world. I thank all the participants for their patience as well as fruitful interaction. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks a lot, sir. I would like to request Dr. Abel Thangaraj, Assistant Professor of Department of Computer Science of Sri Nehru Mahavidyalaya College of Arts and Science, to propose a vote of thanks.
Our words may not be capable of communicating our sense of gratitude. Anyway, on behalf of management, principal, I express my heartfelt thanks to Dr. M. Jayaprakash, Register in Charge, Amit University, Chennai, for his thought-provoking session on teaching and learning methods. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation at this beautiful moment. I wish to express the emotional thanks to all the participants around the country for their patient listening and their enthusiastic attendance. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. See you tomorrow.